The year is 1983. At this point, there is a clear separation between computers used for business and those used for home computing. And one of those defining differences was the number of columns of text on the screen. For example, the poor little VIC-20 only had a 22 column screen. The ZX81 or Timex Sinclair 1000 had 32 columns. The Tandy Color Computer also had 32 columns. The TI-99/4A had 40 columns. Although the Apple II series was originally a 40 column display, by this time an 80 column add-on card was widely available, and most CPM machines like the K-Pro were running at 80 columns. Even the little 5-inch screen on the Osborne 1 was delivering 52 columns. And of course the IBM PC was primarily an 80 column machine from the beginning. But what about the best-selling computer of all time, the Commodore 64? Well, by default, this is a 40 column machine, but I'm going to be showing you four ways to get 80 column text out of this machine and what the pros and cons are of each one. The first method, and probably the most commonly used, was to do it in software. This required putting the C64 into bitmap graphics mode and using a software rendered 80 columns. You see, this is the typical character set that was used on the C64, which is 8 pixels wide. In order to give 80 columns using the built-in video chip, it required cutting all of these in half and using a 4 pixel wide font instead. Still, it doesn't look too bad, right? Well, I'm showing you what it looks like from an emulator, but that isn't really what it looked like on the real thing. Most people were using a television for their monitor, so take a look at how it would appear. Yeah, not very easy to read, is it? And this TV is probably clearer than most were at the time, so lack of visual clarity was the biggest drawback to this method. But other drawbacks included the fact that it would consume at least 8K of RAM for the bitmap screen, as well as additional RAM for the code itself. So for a machine that only has 64K to begin with, that's about 15% of the computer's RAM just to operate with 80 columns.
Another problem is performance. Besides the fact that the software could no longer do direct CPU writes to update the video memory, everything had to be channeled through the 80 column software package, but beyond that, the fact that it had to run in bitmap graphics mode meant that there's a lot more data on the screen to move around.
Not to mention the overhead of drawing the characters in graphics mode, so you can see how slow this is when trying to scroll the information on the screen.
So, without a true 80 column mode, the Commodore 64 was doomed as a business machine.
So, this device was introduced shortly after the C64 came to market, the Data 20 Video Pack 80. It plugs into the Commodore 64's cartridge ROM port. Now, on the back, there are three connectors. One is for a pass-through that takes the audio and video output from the machine's internal graphics chip and routes it through the device. And then the next port is for the usual cable that goes to your monitor. This RCA connector here is actually for audio output, even though I have no idea what purpose it would have served, as it's just the same audio that you would get from this port. If you take a look inside the device, it contains a 6845 screen controller chip, almost identical to what was used in the Commodore PET series. What's more interesting is that it was also identical to the controller chip in IBM's CGA graphics, only it's missing all of the extra circuitry needed for doing color. So this thing will produce only monochrome text. One thing you might notice right away when you turn on the machine is that the video is noticeably degraded from normal. Just for comparison, here's a regular screen and here's going through the cartridge. So the idea is, under normal circumstances, this will pass the normal video from your C64's VIC-2 chip straight through to your monitor. So you don't technically lose any color or graphics capabilities. If you want to actually activate the cartridge in BASIC, you must type SYS36864. This will activate it into 40 columns mode. I'm not sure what good this does, as there is no significant advantage to this mode being it's monochrome only. However, while we're here in this mode, I'll show you some interesting differences in operating. For one thing, the font is different from the regular Commodore font. Also, Shift plus Commodore does not work. For those familiar with Commodore machines, all of the 8-bit machines from the PET all the way to the 128 use this key combination to alternate between an uppercase only font and a font that includes both upper and lowercase. However, you can press Shift F1 to go to lowercase and F1 by itself to go back to uppercase. And you can use F5 and F7 to alternate between 40 and 80 column mode, so the machine works pretty much as expected in this mode. However, one thing you might notice is that while this is clearer than the software-only method of generating 80 columns, it's still pretty hard to read on this television.
So in this case, the blurriness is actually the fault of the color television. You see, the composite video signal is actually surprisingly sharp and clear as long as it's monochrome. Once you shoehorn the color signal into that, it greatly degrades the signal. Now, in the case of this TV, it is a color TV, and even though it's a monochrome signal, it's expecting a color signal, and so the way the circuitry is designed, it just doesn't produce as sharp of a picture.
If you think about it, an RGB signal, such as used on everything from CGA graphics, the Amiga, or even VGA, in reality it's just three individual monochrome signals, one for red, one for green, and one for blue. So if you think about it, there's no reason a single monochrome picture wouldn't be just as clear, except lacking in color. So let's hook up this old Apple monochrome monitor. This monitor was designed to go with the Apple II system, and is very good at displaying 80 columns. Wow, so you can see this thing is super sharp and clear. 80 columns is very readable on this. I can even hook it up to this tiny 5-inch black and white TV, and it's surprisingly sharp, even though my 41-year-old eyes are having trouble focusing on the tiny letters. Another option is this Commodore 1084 monitor. It's designed to take a variety of inputs, including RGB, composite, S-video, and monochrome. Because it's designed for higher resolution, it's actually surprisingly clear as well.
Okay, so I think I've established that if you want to do 80 columns, you're going to need a monitor that can support it. And if you're going to be using a composite video signal, then you're probably going to want a monochrome monitor. Now, believe it or not, monitors like this were actually extremely common back in the 80s, particularly when used in businesses and schools. So I also wanted to talk about one of the big disadvantages of a cartridge like this. There's almost no software out there that actually supports it.
I've managed to locate a spreadsheet program, which I can't entirely figure out how to use, and a word processor as well. I think both were made by the same company that manufactured the device, which makes sense. The other issue is the slow performance. You might notice when writing a basic program that scrolls the screen that the scrolling seems sort of slow. That's because of the way the CPU interfaces with this video chip. You see, the regular Commodore 64 shares its main memory with the video chip. So the CPU can reorganize information on the screen memory, and the video chip will just display whatever is there. It's a very fast arrangement. This device, however, has its own screen memory, so the CPU must send commands one at a time to this device to tell it to put a character on the screen, and this slows down the communication significantly. Alright, so now I want to show you another such device. This is the BI-80, made by Batteries Included. It's a very similar concept, but it uses an RCA input and output. If you take a look inside this unit, you'll see it's based on the 6545 video controller, which is almost identical to the one in the previous unit I just showed you. However, this one is implemented in a very different way. The first thing you might notice is that it produces far less interference when passing through the signal from the internal graphics chip. So, comparing two screenshots from each device, I think it's pretty clear which one does this function better. Another thing I noticed is that BASIC is reporting 8K less RAM than before. So, let's switch it to 80 columns mode. This one requires a different command, SYS33000. So, as expected, it's hard to read on this television, so I'll switch to another monitor. So the next thing I notice is that it is using the standard Commodore 64 font. Also, the Shift Commodore key combination seems to work as expected. And when I do a scrolling test, I notice it's nice and fast. The reason for this has to do with a different way of implementing the screen memory. It's actually sharing the screen memory with a CPU, opposite of how the other device did. This does have several advantages, albeit at the expense of losing some RAM.
Okay, so I searched and searched, and I was unable to find any software that supports this thing. Now, I'm told there was a version of the paperclip word processor that would work with it, which makes sense because they're made by the same company, but I couldn't find a copy of it that actually has support for this on it. But I got to thinking about it, and I wondered how hard it would be to convert one of my own programs to run on this thing.
So, a few years ago I wrote this program called PetDraw. Now, all this does is allow you to use the built-in text characters, which includes the little graphics characters that Commodore put on the keys, and it lets you draw with them in a more convenient fashion, as well as save and load your work. Also, one of the features it has is allowing you to draw in a pseudo bitmapped mode. What this is doing is actually using the little block characters that are part of the character set, and automatically figures out which one is needed in order to let you draw with them seamlessly. And you'd be surprised at some of the things you can draw with just text characters. When I was done with this program, I thought it would be neat to see if I could port it to the Commodore Plus 4, which I did, and it works, taking advantage of all 128 colors. And then I thought, why stop there? Let's see if I can port it to the Commodore PET. Well, the PET has no color, so I had to remove all of the code that involved color. Once I did that, I thought, hey, what about the 80 column version of the PET? So I did that one too. Of course, I don't own a PET, so I've only ever seen this work in an emulator, but it occurred to me that the 80 column PET version would be pretty simple to recompile for the Commodore 64 using the BI80 adapter. After all, both systems use a black and white 80 column screen based on the 6545 CRT controller. All I really needed to do was change a few screen memory addresses in the source code, and sure enough, it works. I didn't change the logo, so it still shows to be the PET 8032 version of the software, but otherwise it works as expected on the Commodore 64. So now, there is at least one software program that is available on the Commodore 64 that supports this thing.
So, I have even updated the PET draw package on my website to include support for this cartridge, along with all the other platforms that it already supports. I won't be able to support this one, at least not easily. It would require doing a complete rewrite in order to handle the way that, that data must be written to this thing. Okay, so I promised to show you four ways to get 80 columns on a Commodore 64. Now, I've shown you three of those so far. Now, as much as I like this cartridge, the problem is with either of these cartridges is they're pretty rare and they're pretty expensive when you do happen to find one. So they're really not a terribly good option. The fourth option might surprise you, which is just simply get a Commodore 128. I mean, it basically is a Commodore 64 inside, and these are actually more common and cheaper to buy than one of these.
And what's crazy about the way the 128 is made is that it actually has two separate video chips inside, and the 80 column chip uses the RGB port exclusively on the back for its output, whereas the traditional graphics chip still uses the regular composite video port.
So in many ways, it's almost like they just took one of these cartridges and just kind of stuck it in there, which I always kind of thought was like a hack and not really a proper way to introduce 80 columns to a machine like this. And ultimately it wasn't very successful because of the fact that it did require a separate monitor on an entirely separate video port. But that's a story for another episode.
However, the 8563 video chip inside the 128 does produce a very sharp and crisp 80 column display and has 16 colors as well, making it much more pleasant on the eye. However, it does require an RGB monitor to accomplish this.
Or does it? It was never widely known, but if you take a look at the pin diagram for the RGB connector on the Commodore 128, you'll notice pin 7 says composite video.
So sure enough, with the proper cable, you can actually connect it to a composite monitor. However, it will only be monochrome, but if you have a monochrome monitor, it will be just as sharp and clear as on the RGB. One slight advantage is that it will output some shades of gray instead of just black and white.
Okay, so ultimately I have to ask the question of why were these never very popular? Well, I spent a lot of time asking myself that lately, and I think the real answer is more than one reason. The first reason is there's kind of a catch-22 with these. You see, nobody really wanted to buy these because there wasn't really a whole lot of software available that made use of them. And on the other hand, there wasn't really a lot of software development being put into these because nobody owned them. So you see that kind of a chicken and egg scenario there. But that's one reason. I think it's there's some other reasons to consider as well. So another problem is there were at least two, and I think there was even a third unit, and they're not even compatible with each other. So if a software developer were to write 80 column support, they would have to pick one of the cartridges or make three different versions of the software. At least on the Apple II, they had the 80 column card, and while Apple did officially make the 80 column card, there were third-party products too, but they were all compatible with each other. So if you wrote software to use 80 columns on an Apple II, you could expect it would work on any of the cards. Another problem is the vast majority of Commodore 64 users did not have a monitor capable of properly displaying 80 columns in the first place. So that was another additional expense that the software developer would have had to expect. And when you think about it, even the 80 column chip in the Commodore 128 was never really that successful. There was only maybe a dozen software titles that were ever produced for it. These machines ended up being primarily game machines. And so there really just, I guess, wasn't that much demand for business software on them in the first place. All right, I am sad to say we have reached the end of this particular episode, but as always, stick around because I have a lot more coming.